18. Jean got busy. Copies of the screenplay were made, mailed to producers, agents, actors. I went back to fiddling with the poem. I also came up with a new system for the racetrack. The racetrack was important to me because it allowed me to forget that I was supposed to be a rider. Writing was strange. I needed to write. It was like a disease, a drug, a heavy compulsion. Yet I didn't like to think of myself as a writer. Maybe I had met too many writers. They took more time disparaging each other than they did doing their work. They were fidgets, gossips, old maids. They bitched and knifed, and they were full of vanity. Were these our creators? Was it always thus? Probably so. Maybe writing was a form of bitching. Some just bitched better than others. Anyhow, the screenplay went around and there weren't any takers. Some said it was interesting, but the main complaint was that there wouldn't be an audience for that type of film. It was all right to show how a person who had once been great or unusual was destroyed by drink. But just to focus on a bum drinking or a bunch of bums drinking, that didn't make sense. Who cared? Who cared how they lived or died? But I did get a phone call from Jean. Listen, Mac Austin got hold of the screenplay and he likes it. He wants to direct it and he wants the same guy I want to play the lead. Who's that? Tom Pell. Yeah, he'd make a good drunk. Pell is crazy for the screenplay. He's crazy about your writing. He's read all your stuff. He's so crazy about the screenplay, he says he'll do the thing for a dollar. Jesus. Only he insists that Mac Austin directs. I do not like this Mac Austin. He is my enemy.
Why?
Oh, we've had some problems. Why don't you guys kiss and make up?
Never! Mac Austin will never direct my film.
All right, Jean, then let's forget it.
No, wait, I want to arrange a meeting at your house between Mac Austin, Tom Pell, and myself, and you, of course. Maybe you can get Tom Pell to change his mind and do the film without Austin. He's a great actor, you know.
I know. So have them come over. Is he going to bring Ramona?
No.
Tom had married Ramona, the famed pop singer.
Well, when would be a good time? They've agreed to tomorrow night at 8:30, if it's all right with you. You move fast. In this game, you move fast or you die.
It's not like chess.
More like a checker game between idiots. One idiot wins, and one idiot loses. I found out a little more about the Jean Pinchot and Mac Austin affair. Although Jean had made most of his films in Europe, and Austin's films were American, the film crowd hung out in the same places in Hollywood. John and Mac Austin were in the same fancy eatery. I am not quite sure who was drinking and who wasn't, but it seems that some bickering started between these two directors from tables not too close together. Shop talk, you know, technique, background, training, insight, etc. It went back and forth between the tables before a goodly audience of people in the industry. Finally, Mac rose and shouted at Jean.
You call yourself a director? You can't direct traffic.
Well, I don't know. Directing traffic is a job that takes great skill. Anyway, some other people had once accused Mac in public of not being able to direct traffic. Now he was passing on the compliment. All's fair in hate and Hollywood. I later heard some other half-documented accounts of run-ins between Mac and John. Anyhow, the meeting was on. Interior. Writer's home, 8:15 p.m. John had arrived a little early.
Wait until you see this Austin, he said. He's off drugs and booze. He's like a flat tire, an empty stocking.
I think it's great, said Sarah, that he has gotten himself cleaned up. That takes courage.
Okay, said John.
They arrived about 8:35 p.m., Tom in leather jacket, Mac in a calfskin jacket with a leather fringe. He had on a half dozen gold chains. Introductions over, I poured Tom a wine. We hunkered around the coffee table. Tom started it off.
I've seen the screenplay. I love it. I want to sink my bicuspids into the fucker. I can taste it already. It's my kind of part.
Thank you, my man. Yours is the only nibble we've gotten.
Tom and I even have a backer. We're ready to roll, said Mac.
You sure you don't want a drink, Mac? I asked.
No, thanks.
I'll get you a soda, said Sarah. Or would you rather have tea?
A soda would be fine.
Sarah went off to get Mac something to make him comfortable. We had health food sodas, the best. I drank my drink right off, poured another. I was beginning to sense a futility about any sort of compromise or agreement.
I need Mac for a director. I know his work. I trust him, Tom said.
You don't trust me? Asked John.
It's not that. It's only that I feel I could work closer with Mac.
I am the only one who will direct this movie, said John.
Listen, said Tom. I know this movie means a lot to you. We can create a position for you. You'll be paid well, and you'll be allowed plenty of control. Please accept this. I want this thing to roll. Please, try to understand.
Sarah was back with Mac's soda.
I know that I can work well with Tom, said Mac.
You can't, John began.
Direct traffic, Mac finished it.
The discussion went on and on for hours. Sarah, John, and I kept drinking. Tom kept drinking. And Mac kept working on the health food sodas.
You're all bullheads, said Sarah. Surely something can be worked out.
But everything was just as it was in the beginning. Nobody gave way, and I had no ideas. I couldn't break the deadlock. We even began talking about other things. We told various funny stories in turn. The drinks went round and round. Toward the end, I don't remember who was telling the story, but it got to Mac Austin. It struck him, health food, sodas and all. He fell backwards, laughing loudly. His gold chains bounced up and down. Then he pulled himself together. Soon after that, it was time to part. Tom and Mac had to leave. We said our goodbyes. After their car backed down the drive, John looked at me.
Did you hear that fake laugh? Did you see how those fucking gold chains bounced up and down on his neck? What was he laughing about? Did you see all those fucking gold chains?
Yeah, I saw them, I said.
He was nervous, said Sarah. He was the only one who wasn't drinking. Have you ever been in a room full of drunks when you aren't drinking?
No, I said.
Listen, John asked me, can I use your phone?
Sure.
I must phone Paris, now.
What?
Don't worry, I will call Collect. I want to talk to my lawyer. It's about an addition to my will.
Go ahead. John walked to the phone and began making arrangements for a connection. I walked over and refilled his glass. Then I came back.
It's awful, said Sarah. There goes the movie.
Well, almost something is better than nothing.
Is it?
Come to think of it, I'm not sure.
Then John had his connection. He'd had more than a few drinks and was excited.
He was easily heard.
Paul, yes, it's Jean Pinchot. Yes, it is urgent. I want an addition to my will. Are you ready? Yes, I'll wait.
Jean looked over at us. This is very important. Then,
yes, Paul, there is this movie. I have control. It is called The Dance of Jim Beam, written by Henry Chinaski. Very well. Get this down. In case of my death, this movie is never to be directed by Mac Austin. This movie can be directed by anybody on this earth except Mac Austin. Do you have that, Paul?
Yes, thank you very much, Paul. Yes, I am well. How is your health?
All right. Anybody but Mac Austin.
Thank you so much, Paul. Good night, good night.
After that, we had one more drink together. Then Jean had to go. He stopped at the door.
Did you hear that fake laugh? Did you see those gold chains bounce?
Yes, John. Then he was gone, and that night was over. We went out to call the cats. We had 5 cats, and we couldn't sleep until all 5 cats were in the house. The neighbors heard us calling those cats late each night or early in the morning. We had nice neighbors, and those 5 cats each took their damned time coming in.
19.
3 or 4 days later, Jean was on the phone.
Jack Bledsoe has read the screenplay, and he likes it. He wants to act in it. I've been trying to get him to come see you, but he claims he doesn't want to be overwhelmed by you. He says you must come see him.
Will that overwhelm him less?
I guess that's what he thinks.
You think he can play the part?
Oh, yes. He's from the streets. He once sold chestnuts in the streets. He's from New York. I've seen some of his films. Well, what do you think?
Maybe. Listen, he's got to stop smiling all the time when he doesn't know what else to do. And he's got to stop beating refrigerators with his fists. And he's got to stop that New York strut where they walk like they've got a banana up their ass.
He used to be a boxer, this Jack Bledsoe.
Shit, we all used to be boxers.
He can do the part, trust me.
John, he can't be New York. This main character is a California boy. California boys are laid back in the woodwork. They don't come rushing out. They cool it and figure their next move. Less panic, all under... And under all this, they have the ability to kill. But they don't blow a lot of smoke first.
You tell him this.
All right, when and where?
It was 8 p.m. in North Hollywood. We were about 5 minutes late. We were walking up various park paths looking for the apartment. I hope he has something to drink.
We should have brought something. I'm sure he'll have something, Sarah said. It was hard to make out the numbers.
Then there was John standing on a balcony.
Up here! I went up the stairway and followed John. It was one of Jack's little hideaways. John pushed the door open and we walked in. They were sitting on an old couch. Jack Bledsoe looked exactly like Jack Bledsoe. Lenny was a big guy, wide, a little too heavy. He was marked by life. He'd been rubbed in it. I liked him. Big sad eyes. Large hands, looked tired, lonely, okay.
Introductions went around. Who's this guy? I asked Jack, nodding at Lenny. Your bodyguard?
Yeah,
said Jack. John just stood there smiling as if the thing was a meeting of great souls, but you never knew.
Got anything to drink? I asked.
All we got is beer. Beer all right? All right, I said. Lenny went off into another room for the beer.
I was sorry for Sarah. She wasn't nutty for beer. There were boxing posters all over the wall. I walked around looking at them.
Great. Some of them went way back. I began to feel macho just looking at them.
There were springs sticking out of the sofa, and there were pillows on the floor, shoes, magazines, paper bags.
This is a real male hangout, Sarah laughed.
Yeah, I like it, I said. I've lived in some real wrecked places, but never anything like this.
We like it, said Jack.
Lenny was back with the beer, cans. We cracked them and sat there having a hit or two.
So, you read the script? I asked Jack.
Yeah. Was that guy you?
Me, long ago.
You got your ass kicked, said Lenny.
Mostly.
You really ran errands for sandwiches? Jack asked.
Mostly. The beer was good. There was silence.
Well, what do you think? John asked.
You mean Jack?
Yes.
He'll do. We may have to beat him up a bit.
Let me see your fighting style, said Jack. I got up and sparred.
Quick hands, said Sarah. I sat down again. I could take a punch fine, but I lacked a certain desire. I wasn't sure what I was doing. You got another beer?
Oh, sure, said Lenny.
Then he got up to get one for me. It was known in Hollywood that Jack Bledsoe didn't like Tom Pell. He liked to lay it on Tom in almost all his interviews.
Tom comes from Malibu. I come from the streets.
It didn't matter to me where an actor came from as long as he could act. Both of them could act, and there was no need for either of them to act the way writers acted. Lenny was back with the beer.
It's the last beer, he said.
Oh, shit, no, I said. I'll be right back, John said. Then he was out the door. Beer run. I liked John.
You like this Jean Pinchot as a director? Jack asked.
You ever seen his documentary on Lido Mamin?
No.
Pinchot has no fear. He loves fucking with death.
He's got a hard-on for death, huh?
Seems so, but he's done other stuff besides the Mamin film. I trust him as a director all the way. He hasn't been deluded by Hollywood, although someday he might be.
How about you?
How about me what?
Will Hollywood get your balls?
No way.
Famous last words?
No, famous first words. Hank hates movies, said Sarah. The last movie he liked was The Lost Weekend, and you know how many years ago that was. Ray Milland's only bit of acting, but it was aces, I said. Then I had to piss, ask directions to the crapper. I went back there, opened the door, went in, did my bit. Then I turned to the sink to wash my hands. What the fuck was that? Pushed down in the sink was this white towel. One end of it was stuffed into the drain, and the remainder of it hung out over the sink and dropped to the floor. It didn't look good, and it was soaking wet, just soaked through. What was that for? What did it mean? Left over after some orgy? It didn't make sense to me. I knew it must mean something. I was just an old guy. Was the world passing me by? I'd lived through some shitty nights and days, plenty of them full of anti-meaning, yet I couldn't figure out that giant, soaking white towel. And worse, Jack knew that I was coming by. Why would he leave that thing in there like that? Was it a message? I walked back out. Now, if I'd been a New Yorker, I would have said, "Hey, what's that fucking white, dripping towel doing in that fucking sink, huh?" But I was a California boy. I just walked out and sat down, saying nothing, figuring that what they did was up to them, and I didn't want any part of it. Jean was back with more beer, and there was an open can where I was sitting. I went for it. Life was good again.
I want Francine Bowers for the female lead, said Jack. I think I can get her.
I know Francine, said Jean. I think I can get her, too. Why don't you both work on it? Sarah asked. Lenny went for more beer. He looked like a bureau. My kind of guy.
Hey, you think there's a part for me in this movie? He asked.
I looked at Jean.
I like Lenny in my flicks, said Jack.
I think there's a part for you, I promise, said Jean. We'll work you in.
I read the script, said Lenny. I think I could play the part of a bartender.
Come on, I said. You wouldn't want to beat up your buddy Jack here, would you?
No problem, said Lenny.
Yeah, said Jack. He already did it once. Knocked one of my teeth out.
Really? Sarah asked. And how? Said Jack. We drank the beer. Mostly it was small talk about the many exploits of Lenny. He not only paid his dues, he could recollect them. When the beer was about gone, I figured it was about time to leave. I made one more bathroom run, then Sarah and I were at the door. John was evidently staying behind to talk over something or other. Then, at the door, something strange happened. I asked Jack,
"Hey, man, what the fuck is that big, sopping, wet, dripping-ass towel doing hanging out of your bathroom sink?"
"What big, sopping, wet, dripping-ass towel?" Jack asked. And that was the end of that particular night. 20.
3 or 4 weeks went by. The phone rang one night. It was Jean.
How are you? How is Sarah?
We're all right. Are you alive?
Yes, and so is the dance of Jim Beam. Francine Bowers read the script and loved it. She even took a cut from her usual salary to do it. Jack did too, but don't tell anybody.
No, but why these cuts?
We're dealing with Firepower Productions. Harry Friedman and Nate Fishman. They cut a hard deal, but everything's signed. There was a snag because Jack's agent demanded a pay-or-play clause in the contract.
What's that?
That means Jack must get paid whether the film is made or not. Most big stars have pay-or-play in their contracts. It's hard to believe there's going to be a movie. Tom Pell had a lot to do with it when he offered to do the thing for $1. It gave the project some credibility. I wish we had Tom. Well, he helped. When Jack heard Tom wanted to do it for $1, then he got interested. Firepower got interested. We got lucky. You know what Lippy Leo DeRocher said?
Who's that?
An old-time baseball player. He said, I'd rather be lucky than good. I think we're lucky and good.
Maybe, but who are those Firepower guys?
They're new in Hollywood. They're outcasts. Nobody knows what to make of them. They used to make exploitation films in Europe. They arrived overnight and began making movies by the score, one after the other. They are hated by everyone, but they deal, although they deal hard. At least they took Jim Beam. Yes, when nobody else would. They have this big building in North Hollywood. I walked into the office and there was Harry Friedman sitting there.
You got Bledsoe and Bowers? He asked.
Yes, I told him.
All right, he said. We've got a movie.
But don't you want to read the script? I asked him.
No, he said.
Interesting man. Hollywood hates him. Too bad. You should see him, a very heavy man. By the way, he's having a birthday party at this place Thursday night. You and Sarah should come. His partner, Nate Fishman, will be there too.
We'll be there. Give me the directions.
Within 10 minutes, the phone rang again.
Hank, this is Tim Ruddy. I'm one of the producers of Jim Beam.
You work for Firepower?
No, I work with John. We are co-producers, me and Lance Edwards.
Oh. Anyhow, do you know Victor Norman?
I've read his books.
Well, he's read you too. He's writing and directing a film for Firepower. And he's going to the party. He wants to know if you'll drop off at the Chateau Marmont to meet him. Then you can go together.
What's his suite number?
That Thursday, we drove up to the Chateau Marmont. The valet took our car and we moved toward the entrance. A smiling, partly bald man was waiting. It was Tim Ruddy. Introductions went around and then we followed him in. Victor Norman answered our knock. I liked his eyes. He looked calm and knowing.
Introductions.
Sarah was looking fine. Norman beamed at her. I shook hands with him, said, "The barfly meets the champ." He liked that. Victor Norman was perhaps the best-known novelist in America. He appeared on TV constantly. He was glib and deft with the word. What I liked best about him was that he had no fear of the feminists. He was one of the last defenders of maleness and balls in the U.S. That took guts. I wasn't always pleased with his literary output, but I wasn't always pleased with mine either.
They gave me the largest suite in the place at a cut rate.
Good advertising, they said, but anyhow, Firepower's picking up the tab. We followed him out on the balcony. A hell of a view of a hell of a town. It was chilly out there.
Listen, man, I asked, don't you have anything to drink around here?
We followed Victor back into the vast connecting rooms. In there you felt protected from everything, a fortress of security.
Nice, nice.
Victor came out holding a bottle of wine.
I've got some wine, but not an opener around. Ah, God, I sighed. An amateur drunk. Victor Norman was on the phone. We need an opener, a corkscrew, some more wine, a few bottles of... He looked at us. It took the wine some time to arrive. I'm making two movies for Firepower. I'm writing and directing one. I'm acting in the other. Jean-Luc Modard is directing. I hope I can get along with him. Good luck, I said. There was some minor conversation. Then Victor told us how he met Charlie Chaplin. It was a good, wild, and funny story. The wine arrived and we sat down. Sarah and Tim Ruddy got to talking. Sarah sensed that Tim Ruddy was feeling left out and was trying to cheer him up. Sarah was good at that. I wasn't so good at that. Victor looked at me. You doing anything now? Fucking with the poem. Victor looked a touch sad. They gave me $1 million to write my next novel. That was a year ago. I haven't written a page and the money's gone. Jesus. Jesus won't help. I've heard about your alimony, all those ex-wives. Yeah. I moved my glass toward him. It was empty. He refilled it. I've heard about your drinking. Yeah. What's those things you're smoking? Beedies from India. The lepers roll them. Really? The wine poured and time passed. Well, I guess we better head for the party, said Victor Norman. We can take my car, I said to Victor. Okay. We went downstairs. Tim Ruddy wanted to take his own car. The valet brought my car around. I tipped him and Victor and Sarah got in. I pulled out and around and headed for Harry Friedman's birthday party. I've got a black BMW too, said Victor Norman. Tough guys drive black BMWs, I said. 21. We were a little late for the party, but there still weren't very many people there. Victor Norman was seated a few tables away from ours. After Sarah and I were seated, the waiter came with our wine. White wine. Well, it was free. I drained my glass and nodded the waiter over for a refill. I noticed Victor peering at me. People were gradually arriving. I saw the famous actor with the perpetual tan. I'd heard that he went to almost every Hollywood party everywhere. Then Sarah gave me the elbow. It was Jim Sary, the old drug guru of the 60s. He too went to many of the parties. He looked tired, sad, drained. I felt sorry for him. He went from table to table. Then he was at ours. Sarah gave a delighted laugh. She was a child of the 60s. I shook hands with him. Hi, baby, I said. Quickly, it began to get crowded. I didn't know most of the people. I kept waving the waiter in for more wine. He then brought a full bottle, plopped it down. When you finish that, I'll bring another. Sarah had wrapped a little present for Harry Friedman. I had it in my lap. Jean arrived and sat at our table. I'm glad you and Sarah could make it, he said. Look, it's filling up. This place is full of gangsters and killers, the worst. John loved it. He had some imagination. It helped him get through the days and the nights. Then a very important-looking man walked in. I heard some applause. I leaped up with the birthday gift. I moved toward him. Mr. Friedman, happy... John rushed up and grabbed me from behind. He pulled me back to the table. No, no, that isn't Friedman. That's Fishman. Oh. I sat back down. I noticed Victor Norman staring at me. I figured he would let up in a while. When I looked again, Victor was still staring. He was looking at me as if he couldn't believe his eyes. All right, Victor, I said loudly. So I shit my pants. Want to make a world war out of it? He glanced away. I got up and looked for the men's room. Coming out, I got lost and went into the kitchen. There was a busboy there, smoking a cigarette.
I reached into my wallet and got a 10. I gave him the 10. I put it in his shirt pocket. I can't take this, sir.
Why not?
I just can't. Everybody else gets tipped. Why not the busboy? I always wanted to be a busboy. I walked off, found the main room again, and the table. When I sat down, Sarah leaned over and whispered, Victor Norman came over while you were gone. He says that it's very nice of you that you haven't said anything about his writing.
I've been good, haven't I, Sarah?
Yes.
Haven't I been a good boy?
Yes. I looked over at Victor Norman, got his attention. I gave a little nod, winked. Just then the real Harry Friedman walked in. Some rose to their feet and applauded. Others looked bored. Friedman sat down at his table and the food was served. Pasta. The pasta came around. Harry Friedman got his and went right in. He looked like an eater. He was wide, yes. He was in an old suit. His shoes were scuffed. He had a large head, big cheeks. He shoved that pasta into those cheeks. He had large round eyes, and the eyes were sad and full of suspicion. Alas, to live in the world! There was a button missing from his wrinkled white shirt near his belly, and the belly pushed out. He looked like a big baby who had somehow gotten loose, grown real fast, and almost turned into a man. There was charm there, but it could be dangerous to believe in it. It would be used against you. No necktie. Happy birthday, Harry Friedman. A young lady came in dressed as a cop. She walked right up to Friedman's table.
You are under arrest, she screamed.
Harry Friedman stopped eating and smiled. His lips were wet from the pasta. Then the lady cop took off her coat and then her blouse. She had huge breasts. She shook her breasts under Harry Friedman's nose.
You are under arrest, she screamed.
Everybody applauded. I don't know why they applauded. Then Friedman motioned the lady cop to bend over. She bent close and he whispered something into her ear. Nobody knew what it was.
Take me to your place. We'll see what happens.
You forgot your club. I'll take care of that.
You come see me. I'll get you in the movies.
The lady cop put her blouse back on, her coat back on, and then she was gone. People came up to Friedman's table and said little things to him. He looked at them as if he didn't know who they were. Soon he was finished eating and was drinking wine. He did well with the wine. I liked that.
He really went for the wine.
After a while, he went around from table to table, bending over, talking to people. Christ, I said to Sarah, look at that.
What?
He's got a little piece of pasta hanging out of one side of his mouth, and nobody is telling him about it. It's just hanging there.
I see it,
said John. Harry Friedman kept walking from table to table, bending over, talking. Nobody told him. Finally, he got closer. He was a table or so away from ours when I stood up and walked over to him. Mr. Friedman, I said. He looked at me from that big monster baby face.
Yes?
Hold still. I reached out, got hold of the end of the pasta, and yanked. It came away. You've been walking around with that dangling. I couldn't stand it anymore.
Thank you, he said.
I went back to our table. Well, well, asked John. What do you think of him? I think he's delightful. I told you. I haven't met anybody like him since Lido Mamin.
Anyhow, said Sarah, it was nice of you to clean that pasta off his face since nobody else had the nerve to. It was very nice of you.
Thank you. I am a very nice guy, really.
Oh, yes? What else have you done that is nice lately?
Our wine bottle was empty. I got the attention of the waiter. He scowled at me and moved forward with another bottle. And I couldn't think of anything nice that I had done lately.